everyone. Hi. How is everyone? Had a good day? Been working hard? Hopefully we'll have a bit more inspiration for you tonight. So thank you for coming to, we're just working out, it's, gosh, these are dirty. It's the first Noisy Thinking of the year. So welcome, and it's gonna be a brilliant one, I know that. I'd like to thank Google. As usual, they have very kindly hosted us in spectacular fashion, so thank you very much to Google. We've got so many coming to Noisy Thinking now, we have to have this big room to accommodate everyone, and those people on the waiting list even. I think we sold out within 20 minutes this time, so thank you for your support. It's fantastic to see you all here. I just want to kick off, I want to thank Flamingo, who, for those who are who come to Noisy Thinking regularly, you'll know that they are a fantastic sponsor, and we thank them very much. And we talked to them about the possibility of doing some short films to intro each of the subject matters to each of our Noisy Thinking episodes. And they've come up with a series entitled Intersections. And each month, each time we do a Noisy Thinking, they've put together a film which hopefully brings to life and inspires you about the theme. This month, the film explores the very idea of strategy, you know, how the concept is different across different cultures, how you bring new ideas together through strategy to inspire new thinking, and what does strategy even mean? 21st century strategy is the theme of tonight. So they've got some thoughts on this that they've put together in a film. So can you run, I want to say, can you run VT?
Strategy is quite a difficult word in Japanese. For starters, there are multiple different translations of it.
There's almost a sense that the concept is foreign, that it comes from the West. Maybe it's even a fictitious concept.
Western notions always struggle in India because they're quite idealistic.
Sen yaku with the characters means sen war, yaku overview.
Kapat vidya, which literally translates back into English as manipulation knowledge. A great example of this is the concept of jugaad. It's the ability to manipulate situations and circumstances and somehow bring them together to make things happen.
Jichingo is basically get things done in your own way or in your way. That's Jichingo mean. It's how you can fast track things, probably because you know someone that can help you with something.
In the marketing and branding context these days, we often use Zhelue instead. It can feel smaller, more tangible.
What you call VUCA and you're beginning to deal with is what we've been calling life in India for a very long time.
Very long time.
Flexibility, it is about quick thinking, adapting to changes. The highest level of wisdom is the ability to harness changes.
Being more flexible, I think here we adapt very easily. We are very creative. I think we try more. We do a lot of mistakes as well. In Europe or in France, it's more, I try to make that perfect word, choosing and picking to have that perfect. And then you go. Here, you don't have the time for that.
Well, thank you, Flamingo. I love the concept of Jichingo. I always think it just means cut the crap, so I'm going to do that and introduce our three fabulous speakers for tonight. Our first speaker is Agathe Guerrier, or AG as I'm going to now refer to her, and she's head of strategy at BBH London, where she's been since 2010, leading strategy on award-winning accounts such as Axe, The Guardian, Mentos and Cronenberg. And she also heads up BBH Labs, which I'm sure you all know about. And previous to BBH, she was a suit, nothing wrong with that, at BETC Euros in Paris, and she was a strategist at Mother. But she's also a yoga teacher and occasional vegan. So Maybe she's channeling Gwyneth Paltrow tonight. You can be the judge of that. She's certainly got some fabulous leggings on. Giles Rees-Jones, he's trying to change the world with three words, which I don't think are I love you, but I guess we'll find out soon. Prior to joining What Three Words, he spent 20 years in advertising, the last 10 at Ogilvy & Mather worldwide, and his clients have included Unilever, Dove, IBM, HP, British Airways, Cisco, and Philips. With them, he won loads of awards for integrated digital, mobile, social, non-traditional campaigns, let's say, and he developed a brand-inspired primetime entertainment TV show. So he's worked across host media. And he's helped, actually, to set up various innovation teams and divisions and agencies through his career, including Saatchi Vision, agency.com, Agency Republic, Ogilvy Labs, and Ogilvy Entertainment UK. But he's here to tell us about his latest venture, which is very interesting. And our third speaker is the wonderful Neil Perkin, the founder of digital and media consultancy, Only Dead Fish. I trust you all know why it's called Only Dead Fish. If you don't, go to the website and find out. A well-known blogger, curator of Google Firestarters, and the co-creator of Fraggle, the brand new Twitter curation app in partnership with Adaptive Lab. And in that capacity, Neil consults on digital content strategy and planning and digital transformation. I'm sure you all know him. And his clients include Google, J&J, the FT, Daily Telegraph, and Samsung. And tonight he's going to tell us, well, he's going to continue the fishy theme because he's going to tell us about mullets, I think. So we're going to kick off with Neil Perkin. Please welcome him to the stage.
Thank you. So yes, I'm going to talk about mullets, not the fishy kind of mullets. I'm going to talk about hair mullets. All right. So mullet strategy is my version of what 21st century strategy is all about. What do I mean by that? Well, this is a phrase which has come from Emily Bell, who did a great lecture, the Hugh Cudlip lecture, quite recently, about 2 or 3 months ago, talking about the future of journalism. In that, she was talking a lot about the transition of newsrooms into being more kind of digitally native. So these kind of digitally native organizations, news organizations like Vice and BuzzFeed, Huffington Post and so on. And so she's talking here about the kind of tabloidization of news and actually not in a negative way, actually in quite a positive way, about the way in which that means that journalism as a profession needs to get way more embedded into digital and what digital means and what it stands for and the culture of digital. And I think there's lots of parallels between, in many ways, what's happening to journalism and what's happening to advertising and to planning. So I'm going to begin with a bit of context here, because I think in many ways you can't really separate the future of strategy and the future of planning without talking about the future of agencies and the kind of landscape in which many of our clients find ourselves. This is a very interesting piece of work that was done by Professor Richard Foster, who's at Yale University. So he did a study on the S&P 500, so the biggest companies in the world, looking at the longevity of those companies, so how long they were around. And he found that the average lifespan of those companies had decreased from about 61 years in 1958 down to about 18 years today. So his prediction was that by 2027, about three quarters of the companies that we know today will not be around in the S&P 500. So as we all know, and we hear a lot about, pace of change is a very real thing within organizations. What does that mean in terms of marketing? Well, I think it actually means a lot of marketers are quite scared at the moment. This is interesting data from IBM. They do lots of CMO and CTO and CIO studies. So this is taken from their CMO study. Just asking them about how much they think their role is going to change. Obviously, a lot of them thinking that their role will change over the next year, 3 years. But the interesting one down the bottom there, about 40% of them think that they need to reinvent their roles. Think about that, reinvention of what their role is all about. But only 14% of those people really know how to do that. Yeah, so I think we've got potentially quite a lot of confusion around. And no wonder, because lots of horrendous visuals like that, yes? I mean, this is done by a guy called Scott Brinker, who writes an excellent blog on marketing technology. And every year he does quite an informal survey about marketing tech companies and does this sort of map. So this was done back in January, and he identified about 2,000, over 2,200 marketing technology companies in this space, which had doubled from the same survey that he did a year before. So, you know, not a particularly scientific survey and just one guy doing it, but you can see the kind of interesting landscape that we all operate in now. And at the same time, you've got clients talking about different things. So this is quite fresh data, which has come from eConsultancy. So they do a big survey at the beginning of every year, thinking about what marketers find interesting, exciting over the next year. So the single most exciting opportunity to 2015 is customer experience. Customer experience, yeah. Second one, content marketing. Yeah. So that word, that phrase, you know, which is being talked about all the time right now, wasn't around 2 or 3 years ago. Suddenly it's the second most exciting thing that marketers are thinking about right now. Certainly is a short-term opportunity. And customer experience, I think, speaks to that kind of desire that clients have to join things up, to create consistent but differentiated experiences across lots of different touch points. And then you have companies doing really interesting things, like a consumer electronics company that has over 750 million views on YouTube. You've got a soft drinks company that has 700 people sat in a building in Salzburg, Austria, as a media organization that's bigger than some media owners, in fact, bigger than many media owners. And of course, you have really interesting data-driven businesses like Amazon, who do content really, really well. So, you know, their content customization so good, they have something, I think the latest figure is 248 million monthly active customers that Amazon has, 300 different bits of content on their homepage. Each of those is directly customizable according to your history. So no single person out of that ever sees the same homepage. So think about that, 248 million homepages, separate homepages that Amazon is serving up to its customers every single month. I mean, that is some content capability. Then you have businesses which are transforming themselves in a very short space of time. So Facebook moving in the space of little more than 2 years from being an entirely desktop-based business to one where the majority of their revenues come from mobile. I mean, I can't think of any other example of a company that has changed its revenue generation portfolio to that extent in such a short space of time. And, you know, it's all connected really in interesting ways, yeah? So look at the search that I've done. That film with Ben Affleck, that's terrible. So all Google needs is the words film, Ben Affleck, and terrible to know that Gili is the top result. I mean, arguably it could have been a lot of Ben Affleck films, couldn't it? But Gili is right at the top there. So the context of how people are talking and writing about that and that piece of content, it means that that's the top search result. So moving away from the importance of keywords into context, the power of context, you know, isn't that interesting? So let's think about mullet strategy and what we really mean by that. So I think, as I said at the beginning, you can't really separate the future of strategy from the future of agencies. But I think sometimes the discussion about where agencies are going and indeed where strategy is going can feel a bit like this. Run VT, as they say.
This year has brought together competitors from over 4 million different countries. And here we are at the start of the first event of the afternoon, the second semi-final of the 100 yards for people with no sense of direction. I'll just give you the competitors. Lane 1, Skolimowski of Poland. Lane 2, Zatapatik of France. Lane 3, Grobovich of the United States. Next to him, Drabble of Trinidad. Next to him, Fernandez of Spain. And in the outside lane, Borman of Brazil. Well, that was fun, wasn't it?
So I think, you know, we're in danger of going off in all kinds of directions with this, but I did a really interesting piece of work a couple of years ago now, which was around the future of agencies. And as part of that, I interviewed about 30 different senior agency personnel from across Europe and lots of different types of agencies, so creative media, technology, integrated, and so on. So there was this really interesting model that I happened to have come across shortly before I did that piece of work, which from a book called The Experience Economy. It's not a new book, it's been around for many years, but it talks about the progression of economic value. So this idea of moving from just simply making goods to delivering services and then, you know, staging experiences and then ultimately guiding transformation. So the point here is about customization versus commoditization. And as markets become commoditized, you have to move to the next stage in order to create economic value. And I think that struck me as a really interesting model to think about the future of agencies. And so we constructed this model, which was around the progression of agency value, thinking again about moving from delivering services into this kind of idea of staging experiences on behalf of or with your clients and their customers. And then ultimately driving change within the client organization itself through the action of what you're doing. So, I mean, that's the model we came up with. Lots of things around data, technology, skills, culture. You know, arguably most agencies may be in the middle bit here, not that many sort of along the right-hand side there. But the important thing here, of course, is that it's not just about technology. It's about all the things that surround the technology as well. So let's think about that in terms of strategy. And, you know, it's interesting. You know, I'm a blogger. And you know, we seem to see this question come up a lot on blogs, and people talk about what is strategy. And I think that's kind of interesting because, you know, surely we should know the question, we should know the answer to that question by now. But I think, you know, what's going on here is possibly that the fundamentals of strategy isn't changing, but what is changing is the context of how strategy is applied. So this enormously long quote is from Lawrence Friedman. So strategy, a history. So I've actually purloined this from Martin Riegel's blog, excellent blog. And I think it's a great definition of, you know, what strategy is, because it talks about how, you know, nothing's perfect, things change. Yeah, so strategy in many ways has always been fluid, flexible, and it's this continuous process, yeah, of readjustment. And in many ways, I think, you know, that's as true now, if not more true. So we have to be more fluid, more flexible, and the continuous bit is more important. So Noah Breyer, who runs Percolate in New York, wrote a great post about strategy as algorithms, building on that idea. And I really love the thought of strategy as an algorithm. And what he's talking about here is not the machine-driven bit of it, but actually the fact that you know, and all an algorithm is a set of rules that you apply to a given situation to optimize the output. But there is a very human part to algorithms, because you still need humans to design what those rules are. You know, the algorithms are constantly changing. Google makes up to 600 changes to its algorithm every single year. And every quarter, you know, there's a major update, because you need to make a major adjustment because of the changing nature of your environment. So that combination of people and technology, I think, is really interesting. So average is over, Tyler Cohen, he talks about you know, how the definition of what good is changing, and it's people's ability to how well they work with intelligent machinery, with algorithms. You know, how are you a complement to it or are you not? And I think that combination of people and technology is really important for the future. So Rita Gunter McGrath is a Columbia Business School professor. So in this book, I mean, that's the summary of the book. You don't need to buy the book now. But so this is really what she's saying in that book. But I think the interesting point she's saying in that book is that the nature of organizational strategy is changing from creating sustainable advantage to a situation where it's all about transient competitive advantage, and you're moving from one advantage to the next. So that means, you know, a number of different things in terms of how you engage in markets, how you disengage from markets, the structures that you have, the way in which you allocate resources, the way in which you organize resources around opportunity. And I think that is interesting for strategy, because what she also says is that strategy is joining up with innovation, which is also joining up with transformation. So for me, it's about, you know, where these things come together, strategy starting to look more like innovation, which is starting to look more like organizational change. And so if anything, the areas of overlap between things like strategy and planning and service and experience design and organizational change are really interesting areas in which to play. So some examples of, you know, that kind of thinking, the idea of the vertical stack, so technology companies like Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon, developing a presence at different sort of layers in this ecosystem. So this is my version of what that looks like, you know, hardware, creating value out of hardware through an operating system of some kind. Then you've got, you know, content, and they need to access that content, and payment systems, and then context. You know, we know where you are, we know who your friends are, and your identity, default identity on the web is ours. So, you know, of course, the thing that this is all about is about data. It's about creating joined up experiences. taking value from one place in this stack and using it to enhance the experience at another place. So what's your client's version of that vertical stack? It's likely to be all the different customer touch points. That, to me, is what a planner is all about. It's about taking value from one place, bringing it to enhance the value in another place. So in many ways, it's about optimizing business as usual. In this book, The Power of Pull, Hegel, Seeley, and Brown talk about, you know, stuff that goes on in the center, all the kind of core stuff, business as usual, how can you make that better? But also, how can you add value at the edges? You know, innovation happens at the edges. That's about emergent setup, you know, design, and improving capability. But also, how can you join up, you know, the people and technology bit? This is a very interesting study from MIT Sloan and Capgemini, studied 400 companies over about 4 years, looking at people invested in technology. So you've got digital intensity up the left-hand side, and you've got what they call transformation management intensity on the bottom axis there. That's all the stuff that surrounds the technology. It's the people, cultures, behavior. So the digerati there, companies that invested in both of those things were 26% more profitable than the average across those 400 companies over that time. Those that invested only in technology and not the culture, behaviors, skills, 11% less profitable. So final thought is really just about, you know, content marketing. So you know, the science fiction writer Theodore Sturgeon, of course, Sturgeon's revelation, which you may well have heard of, about 90% of everything being crap. And actually, I think there's a lot of truth in that. You know, 90% of advertising is arguably pretty crap. 90% of content marketing is probably definitely crap. 90% of most things are crap. But actually, you know, the planner's job for me is about stop stuff being crap, yes? So for me, it's about, you know, the mullet strategy is about being neat and respectable at the front, wild and hairy at the back. The neat and respectable bit is about sharing experiences, having great insight, all the foundational stuff of good planning, but also, you know, not being crap. Wild and hairy at the back is about that continuous experimentation, being responsive, guiding transformations within organizations, having a wider footprint within organizations in this idea of continual strategy. So a wonderful, wonderful piece in The Guardian, Oliver Burton last year, saying, yeah, everybody's basically just winging it. Doesn't matter if you're Barack Obama or me, you're just basically winging it. And I think in a sense, we need to actually wing it a bit more with our clients. And that to me is really what 21st century is all about. So thank you.